Twisted Justice, written by William Bernhardt, narrated by William Bernhardt. Chapter 1. Elena emerged from the water an inch at a time, first the top of her head, then her forehead, her face, her neck. She moved slowly, clinging to the ocean bed as if walking underwater came naturally, as if she were a mermaid who had suddenly discovered her legs. Her shoulders rose above the waterline, then her arms, her breasts. She imagined herself as Botticelli's Venus emerging from a watery half-shell, hair slicked back, body on display for all to see.
"Mama, look! That lady isn't wearing anything!"
"Where did she come from?" another voice asked. "I've been on this beach all day."
"She's hurt! Someone do something!"
Elena heard the cries echo in the clouded reaches of her mind, but the meaning of the words did not register. She had been damaged, and she had traveled so far, so fast. Each step was a struggle. She moved like an automaton, like a relentless sea nymph with nothing to hide, no cause for shame, each step a triumph only she understood. The sand oozed between her toes, slowing her, but the sun felt so warm on her body that she almost wanted to cry.
"Hey, kid, you need some help?"
For the briefest of moments, she allowed her gaze to drift. She was bruised and blood-blemished, on her arms, on her left thigh, on the side of her face. Venus should be immaculate, not battered and beaten. Barely alive. How much had she lost? How much more could she lose? Someone ran beside her, a young man, a little older than she was, bearded, bloated, hardly Michelangelo's David, but bearing a concerned expression.
You want my towel?"
She tilted her head slightly. Why would she want his towel? The sunshine was a delightful change after so many days of darkness.
"You know, to cover yourself."
Her gaze intensified. A small crease formed between her eyebrows.
Maybe you don't know, but you lost your suit. And I think somebody already called the cops."
Her suit? Did he mean her rags? Her slave clothes? She was glad to be rid of them.
"You should probably see a doctor, too. You're pretty banged up."
A doctor. A doctor. She thought she knew what he meant. Her brain was still muddy like the soil beneath her feet. But she couldn't allow that. She couldn't bear to be trapped, confined, not again. She fought so hard to be free. Better to bleed to death than be a prisoner.
"Look, I don't mean to be pushy, but I know a guy. I could get you in to see him. And then maybe we could get you some clothes and a hot cup of coffee. You'll feel better and..."
She ran. Bolted away with all the speed she could muster. She kept running until she reached a brown, dirty strip surrounded by tall trees. 2 more seconds and she found a sidewalk. A second after that, a street. Cars zigzagged across her field of vision. She barely recognized them. It had been so long. But she had to make it across. She had to flee. She darted into the street. Horns blared. Brakes squealed. She heard shouting in a tongue she did not understand. "Keep moving," she told herself. "Don't let them capture you." Water flew off her hair and skin as she increased her speed. She heard a whistle somewhere behind her.
"Stop! Hey, stop!"
No, 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 no. She could not let it happen to her, not again. She would not be someone else's tool. She had to be free.
"Please stop! You're hurt!"
She knew she was injured, but she also knew she would get better. If only they would leave her alone. She looked around desperately, trying to find some place to hide. Shops, restaurants, bicycles, boats. She didn't know where she was. She didn't know where she would be safe. She heard rapid footsteps gaining on her. She collided into people, trying to move faster. She hit a large woman full on and knocked her to the pavement. The woman shouted. Suddenly, everyone was looking at her. Suddenly, there was nowhere to run. Someone tackled her from behind. She fell hard. Her bare knees scraped against the concrete. Blood rose to the surface.
"Miss, I'm taking you into custody for your own safety. Do you know where you are?"
He whipped her body around to face him. He wore a uniform, glittering pieces of metal. She tried to struggle. He grabbed her fists and forced them down, pinning them between her breasts.
"I'm sorry, miss. You're not leaving me any choice."
A second later, he snapped cuffs around her wrists. She screamed. It was a loud, keening scream, like something a banshee might release, piercing and penetrating, sharing her pain with everyone who heard it. A large crowd gathered around them.
"Kid, please, I'm just trying to help you. Are your parents around here?"
She did not answer. She did not know what to say.
"Do you have anyone? Anyone we could call?"
She tried to remember, tried to bring back the shattered remnants of what came before. But it was so hard. And part of her didn't want to remember.
"Can you at least tell me who you are?"
Something triggered inside her head. "I am the wave that aches for the shore. I am the fire that never burns cold. I am the lover who can never be kissed." Holding her between the arms, the man raised her to her feet. Between the gash in her side and the bruises on her knees, she could barely stand.
"Sure, whatever. But can you give me a name?"
She thought hard for a moment, and when she finally spoke, her voice cracked and fizzled like sea spray in the morning. "Anatole." The man peered at her, squinting. He gave her a quick once-over.
"You're saying your name is Anatole?"
Her eyelids fluttered.
"Belasco."
"Belasco? George Belasco? He's dead."
"Easy. Easy!"
She shrieked, and all the strength went out of her. Her legs buckled, but for the man holding her, she would have crumpled to the pavement.
"Please don't let them take me back."
Her eyes closed, and she could feel her consciousness fading.
"Save the others,"
she mumbled, her last words before the sleep came.
"Before it's too late."
Chapter 2. Many weeks before. Dan rolled over, but the bed on his boat was so small that moving even slightly put him halfway on top of Camilla.
"What's that racket?"
She blew hair out of her face.
"Someone is at your front door. If you can call it that."
He immediately tensed.
"Relax, Dan. Murderous thugs don't knock."
Sound point. And they would have come in the dark. The sun was already rising. Camilla touched his shoulder.
"Probably just a client who needs the city's most famous defense lawyer and can't wait for business hours."
"Maybe. Still weird." He grabbed a robe. "I'll see who it is."
"Right behind you."
"You don't have to."
"Just in case. You need a martial arts mayor to take them out."
A minute later, he was topside. He opened the outer door of the boat. Camilla stood behind him, covering herself with a sheet. Detective Kakazu waited outside.
"Jake? Kind of early. What's going on?"
He glanced at the two officers standing behind Kakazu, Sergeant Enriquez, and a cop he didn't know.
"I'm surprised you were sleeping," Kakazu said. "We've been awake all night."
"That doesn't explain why you're bothering us. Look, if this is some crap Belasco put you up to, forget it. Leave me alone." The officers looked at one another. Kakazu drew in his breath.
"It does involve Belasco, in a way. He's dead."
Dan's lips parted. The district attorney? Dead? When? How?
We're just beginning to unpack the details. Camilla
pushed. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.